morning, church. My aunt Sarah here. We want to welcome you to Morningside today. We're so glad you chose to worship with us. Why don't you stand and sing?
Nothing can stop us. Nothing can hold us down. Death is defeated. Jesus, you've overcome. See, nothing can stop us. Nothing can hold us down. Death is defeated. Jesus, you've overcome. Shout it out, He is risen. Our God is alive in us. Shout it out, He is risen. Our God is alive.
He'll never leave us.
Never leave us. Your love is like the morning sun, shining down on us. Jesus, you have overcome. You will never leave us. Your love is like the morning sun, shining down on us. Jesus, you have overcome.
Time, He is risen, it is done, and I
gonna shout like the battle's won.
Come on, tell them.
Fall back, devil, cause the time is up. I'm gonna live like the stone is gone, gone. Now my sin is dead and gone, and I sing hallelujah. Done, done, he is risen, it is done, and I sing hallelujah.
How great the power of the blood. Come on, church.
Wasn't for his blood and for the blood that was shed on the cross, we wouldn't be where we are today. So do you mind if I teach you guys a new song today? It talks about his blood and how his blood speaks a better word, because him going to the cross, it rewrote history. I know it rewrote mine. It made everything right. So I'm going to sing this chorus for you. If you guys can listen, then I'm going to have you guys sing it. The words are simple. It just says, it's singing out with life, and it's shouting down the lies. It echoes through the night. The precious blood of Christ speaks a better word.
It's singing out with life. It's shouting down the lies. It echoes through the night. The precious blood of Christ speaks a better word. Speaks a better word.
You guys got that? Can you sing this with me this next time? Sing this out.
It's singing out with life. It's shouting down the line. It echoes through the night. The precious blood of Christ speaks a better word. Speaks a better word. Your blood is here.
making all things new. Your blood speaks a better word. Your blood, the measure of my worth. Your blood, more than I deserve. Your blood speaks a better word. Speaks a better word. Sing this out.
It's singing out with life. It's shouting down the lines. It echoes through the night. The precious blood of Christ speaks a better word. Speaks a better word. Your blood, the robe of righteousness. Your blood, my hope and my defense. Your blood forever covers me. Oh, forever covers me.
Through the night, the precious blood of Christ speaks.
everything you've done. Thank you for going to that cross so that you can rewrite history, so that you can make everything right. Thank you for doing that so that we can be here today and praise and worship your holy name and give you the glory for everything you've done. Because you gave me a brand new destiny. You gave me life in you. We're thankful. You made a way in the darkness when there seemed to be no way. But you made it happen, Lord. Thank you for that. Lord, I ask that you will bless our offerings as we give them to you today. Lord, and let us give with a cheerful heart and a thankful heart, knowing that for everything you've done for us, we can just give you this little bit back as an act of worship and as a way of saying thank you. Lord, we love you so much, and we thank you for everything. In your name we pray. Amen.
Just your voices. He is. Declare that this morning. Who is he? This morning, we thank you.
Amen.
That you are the way maker. You are still to this day a miracle worker, a promise keeper, over 7,000 promises in your word to your children, that you are a light in a dark, dark world, and that we can trust you to show us the path and show us the way. And we thank you for that this morning. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated if you can. Yeah. You can clap. That's okay. Go ahead. Gave me just enough time to get my notes ready, right? So take out your outline in your program there, and do not panic when you see that it is 4 pages long. Remember, we just sang, God is a way maker. He's a miracle worker, right? We will get through this outline, I promise. It's not every day your pastor brings 2 messages to share with you. You're in luck today. It's a 2-for-1, okay? And so, you know, people like that around 5 or 6 o'clock in the evening, so you're getting it today. 2-for-1. God's word, though, not the other stuff. All right, so open your Bibles to Mark chapter 6. That's where we're going to be in just a little bit. But I'm just going to share that the groups, if you've signed up, even if you haven't signed up, it's not too late, but groups are going to be meeting here on this campus on Thursday nights at 6:30. And also Sunday morning, this next Sunday morning is our first group for this study, a six-week study diving deeper into what we've been talking about, what we will be talking about in Daring Faith. So the first group is this Thursday at 6:30 here, or Sunday morning, 9 a.m. Will be this coming Sunday morning for the group. So I encourage you to get involved with that. Now, this morning what I want to do for just a couple minutes is I want to look at kind of where we're going to be going for the next several weeks. And so if you've got your notes, we're going to talk about what the Daring Faith campaign is all about. So what is it? It's a two-month focus. I think this is on the top of your outline there. The Daring Faith campaign is a two-month focus on growing, sowing, and going in faith. Growing, sowing, and going in faith. And this first part, I'm probably going to talk faster than I normally do because I really want to get to Mark chapter 6 and the feeding of the 5,000 and the miracle that Jesus did there. So, but this is really important for you to get. So just kind of see if you can follow along with me for a minute. So we're going to do two-month focus on growing, sowing, and going. So let me show you three verses. The first one is in Colossians chapter 2. It says, "Let your roots grow down into him." In other words, deep into him, and draw up nourishment from him so that you will grow in faith. I would circle that phrase, grow in faith, strong and vigorous. God's plan for you, God's plan for me, God's plan for your children and my children and all the generations after is that we would grow in faith. We first have to grow in faith if we expect our children to be able to grow in faith, right? So it's not, God doesn't want us to remain spiritual babies. And then God said, I want you to go and sow in faith as well. In other words, God says, I want you to learn to become generous people. Because you can't become like God without being generous. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. So this is the law of you reap what you sow. Anybody's parents ever teach them that, right? Like five of you, okay? But you reap what you sow, right? If you sow criticism, then you're going to reap criticism, right? If you sow love, then you're going to reap love. If you sow kindness, you're going to reap kindness. So you grow in faith, you sow in faith, and then God wants you to go in faith. And that's, we see in a great example there. I could have picked all kinds of examples, but the one I chose is Abraham in Hebrews chapter 11 verse 8 says this. It says, it was by faith that Abraham obeyed God's call to do what? Go, right? And so he's leaving the land of Ur, the place where he's always been, and going to the promised land. And so he left his own country without knowing where he was to go. Now, question I would ask is, would you do that? Abraham's like, he's retirement age, right? No, God, I want to kick back. I want to collect my pension. I just want to chill, you know, and maybe take a cruise or something. Maybe not with coronavirus. I don't know. But So Abraham's like, I'm comfortable, but God calls him to go, and what does he do? He goes. So why are we doing this? Well, we're doing this because everything that God does in your life, he does because of his mercy and his grace and your faith. Did you get that? Everything that God does in your life, he does because of his mercy and his grace and your faith. He does it by grace through faith. And I could give you 100 different verses, but let me just give you a few. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. There is enough right there that we could do a 10-week study just on that. Romans chapter 14, verse 23 says, anything that is not done in faith is what? Sin. Another reason to study faith. Anything not done in faith is sin. So we could spend another 10 weeks studying that. And then Matthew 9:29, Jesus said, according to your faith, it will be done to you. I love that because basically that verse, according to your faith, it will be done to you. Jesus is saying, you know what? You get to choose how much I bless you. If you have a lot of faith, then you get a lot of blessing, right? If you have a little faith, then you get a little blessing. If you have no faith, then you get no blessing. Right? So you guys are catching on. Man, Saturday night was like trying to resurrect the dead. I'm not good at that. Only God does that, you know? So listen, there are four purposes of this Daring Faith campaign. So I want you to write these down. The first purpose of the Daring Faith campaign is this, to advance our spiritual maturity. Now, I talked to you a little bit about this when we went through the book of James because that's what the book of James is about too. I want you to grow up spiritually. I want you to become spiritually mature, right? A little baby goes from drinking its mother's milk to eating some, you know, blended cereal to eventually eating more solid foods to eventually now you get people like me. I like steak. I like chicken. I like mashed potatoes. I like a good bowl of ice cream. Like, you know, we eat solid foods. So we want you to advance in your spiritual maturity. A muscle only gets stronger by doing what? By stretching it, right? By putting tension on it, by putting pressure on it. So what I want to do is I want to put a little spiritual weight on your spiritual muscles. I want to stretch you a little bit. James chapter 1 says, when your faith is tested, or when your faith is stretched, your endurance has a chance to grow. So let it grow, for when your endurance is fully developed, you'll be strong in character, and read it with me, ready for anything. That's what I want to be true in your life. I want you to be ready spiritually, emotionally, ready for anything that comes at you. And the Bible says that this is the way to do this, is by developing our faith muscles. So we let it grow. So we're going to advance our spiritual maturity. Number two, we're going to enhance our relational unity. This is the whole group factor, right? Having groups on Thursday, groups on Sunday. I talked to somebody this morning. They found this study in the YouVersion Bible app, and they're doing a group. They're doing a group online with their friends so that they can study even when they can't get together. I think that's awesome. Using technology, using the gifts that God has given us to still have our fellowship, still grow each other in the faith, right? How do we do that? We do it by cooperating together. We enhance our relational unity by cooperating together. The Bible tells us in the book of Acts, the believers in the Jerusalem church were united in their hearts and spirit. Why? It tells us why. Because they shared all they had with each other. Imagine that. They shared. We teach our kids to do that, but sometimes as adults, we're not so good at it, if we're being honest, right? But they shared all they had with each other. In fact, people would sell what they owned, even their homes. How many want to line up and sell their home for the cause of the kingdom, right? And we don't think about it that way anymore, but they did in those days, and give the money as an offering. They would sell everything they owned. They would sell even their homes and give the money as an offering. Why? To further the kingdom. Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart is also. And wherever you put your time, wherever you put your money, wherever you put your interest, that's what you're going to feel close to. So we're going to enhance our relational unity by cooperating together, by coming together in the groups, by studying together, and by growing together. Number three, and this is the one where everybody gets a little squirrely on me. Number three is to finance our local and global ministry and missions through an offering and our weekly giving. I don't know if you have enough room to even write all that in the outline, but there it is. The purpose of this, it's a campaign to finance our local and global ministry and missions through an offering and weekly giving. So in a couple of months, we're going to do a big offering. We're going to receive a big offering to get us started towards our goals. And some of you in here, I know some of you are new to the West Campus, but some of you have been at Morningside a long time. So you might remember, I can remember as a little kid, going through different campaigns for our ministry. Or for God's ministry, I should say. Some were called Building Our Tomorrows, or God's Challenge Our Choice, or Step Up, or Stretch to the Cross was another one. Now we're doing Daring Faith, and it's time for us to step up again as a church. So we're going to finance the ministry that God is putting before us. Paul says this in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. What we're hoping for, and by the way, this is my prayer for you as your pastor, what we're hoping for is that as your lives grow in faith, you'll play a greater part in expanding our work. How have we expanded our work in the time that we've been at Morningside? How have we expanded moving forward? How are we going to expand moving forward? Well, let me tell you a few of the ways. These aren't on your outline, but if you want to write down so that you know what we're doing, one of the ways is I've told you we have 12 churches in Haiti, and we have a nutrition center in Haiti where we give little children multivitamins every single day and at least one hot meal every day. And at that nutrition center, we also have a generator that costs, I don't know, over $30,000 that we put in and dug a well, and it serves a community of almost 3,000 people. And the women every day come early in the morning with the bucket on their head, and they fill the bucket up with water, and it's like a 5-gallon bucket, and then they put it back on their head and they put their arms down and they walk away with this bucket of water on their head. I don't know, I could never do that. Balance isn't my thing to begin with, but it's amazing to see. And they go home and they cook with this water, and when they're done cooking with the water, then they take a bath with it. Now imagine that. Like, we don't even have to picture that in our society. We have fresh water that, you know, you turn the faucet on, there it is. But that's how they live. So we want to enhance their quality of life there. We want to dig another well, and we want to put another well in so that there's another community that can have fresh water. So that's one of the ways that we're going to expand our work. Another is through what's called Evangelical Friends Mission. We belong to Evangelical Friends Mission, actually. We're partners with them. And what they do is they plant churches all around the world. And so a portion of the giving that we do here every week goes to Evangelical Friends Mission. And we have church plants in India and Burundi and Africa and I'm trying to think where else. Bolivia and Hong Kong and Taiwan. And, I mean, the list just goes on and on. We're going to one in El Salvador in just a couple weeks with our youth. And so they plant missionaries that then go and they plant these churches and go and spread the gospel to communities around them. One of the other things that we want to do with some of the funds that we're going to raise is you heard me talk when we talked about Africa, when I talked about Africa, you heard me mention that you can actually plant a church in Tanzania, Africa for $50,000. That's a church of 300, so a room this size, right? A church of 300 with two pastor's offices and three Sunday school classrooms, electricity, roof, fans, the whole nine yards, right? $50,000 builds all of that. And so I'm talking to Compassion International about the possibility of doing that in Tanzania. And so that's one of the other things that we want to do. And whether you know this or not, because I don't always talk about it, but if you come to some of the congregational meetings, you would hear this. We've actually helped start 10 new churches in the United States in the last 5 years. And we've actually started 5 new churches just in the last year alone. So we do our best to be good stewards of what God has blessed us with, what you are generous with. And so there's a reason that we are going to pour into this, because God said that we're not just supposed to be concerned about ourselves. We're supposed to be concerned about the people outside of these doors, the people in our community, and the people around the world, right? Go ye therefore into all the world, teaching and preaching the gospel, right? Making disciples. And so that's what our goal is. Morningside has a great past. We celebrate 44 years this year, but that's nothing compared to where we're going. So I would say to you this morning, it's time to buckle up. It's time to get ready, because I make no apology in saying that what you're doing here in the church in the next few years at Morningside is probably, it may be the most significant thing you ever do with your life. Why do I say that? Because whatever you do in the church and in expanding God's kingdom, it's going to last longer than your career. It's going to last longer than your hobbies. It's going to outlast everything else you do. Why? Because it's going to last for an eternity. It's making an eternal difference. And that's what God's called us to do. When I read 2 Corinthians chapter 8, I think of our congregation. It could be written of us too. Paul says this. He says, since you already excel in so many ways, you have so much faith, such gifted teaching, so much knowledge, so much enthusiasm, and so much love, I now want you to grow and excel in the ministry of generous giving. So that's one of our goals. It's one of the four goals. And then number four is this: to honor the everyday heroes of the faith that are serving in our church family. To honor the everyday heroes of the faith that are serving in our church family. So every single weekend, starting next weekend, every single weekend, we're going to honor somebody that has been serving faithfully in this ministry, because we want each and every one of you to know how much we appreciate you. The children's workers, you hardly ever, unless you've got kids, some of you don't even know, there's children workers that don't even get to sit in the service because they're serving each and every week. We've got so many people that are integral parts of this ministry, and so we're going to honor them each and every week. Paul gives an example of this in Philippians chapter 2. He writes to the church in Philippi from jail. He's writing, and he writes to the church in Philippi, and he says, Epaphroditus works, aren't you glad your mom didn't name you Epaphroditus, right? It works and serves with me in the army of Christ. When I needed help, you sent him to me. Welcome him back in the Lord with much joy. Here's the point. Give honor to people like him, not just to him. Give honor to people like him. Who was he? He was a servant. He was generous with his time. He traveled to see Paul. He delivered a letter to him. He risked his life, Paul says, to give me the help I needed that you could not provide. So whenever, I know whenever we talk about giving and offerings, people get a little nervous, right? The most sensitive nerve, you've heard me say this, runs from the heart to the wallet, right? So Morningside, listen, is a very unique church. There are some things that we just won't do here that other churches, other organizations will do. So let me explain to you just for a minute what we will do and what we will not do, okay, during this campaign. Things that we won't do. We won't pressure anyone to give, okay? We won't pressure anyone to give. In fact, we are opposed to pressure. Why are we opposed to pressure? Because, listen, the Bible says to never give under pressure. The Bible says never give under pressure. Why? Because we're to give from a place of joy. You're to give out of joy. And listen, if you can't give out of joy, then don't give. Let me just make it really clear. In about 2 months, we're going to have a big offering to fund some of these new missions and these new ministries that I'm talking about. And some of those are even going to be local ministries, partnering with food banks and things like that to make a greater impact on our community. But listen, some people say, you know what? I don't want to do that. Here's what I would say to you. Don't. Don't. I'll let you off the hook right now. Don't do it then. Because listen, if you feel pressure, it doesn't work. If you give because you felt pressure, you're not getting any credit for that. Why? Because that's not what God wants. What does the Bible say in 2 Corinthians 9, chapter 9? It says, each one should give what he has decided. In other words, I can't tell you what to give. I can't tell you what to do. And it says, what he's decided in his heart to give. Not reluctantly or under pressure, for God loves what? A cheerful giver. God loves a cheerful giver, not a grumpy giver, not a whiny giver, not somebody who's complaining all the time. No, God loves a cheerful giver. So when you bring an offering, it should be done cheerfully. So we're not going to pressure anybody. The second thing that we're not going to do, we just don't believe in it here at Morningside, is we won't sell anything. Okay? We will not sell anything. The difference between giving and fundraising is, in fundraising, I give you a reward for your money. I give you something for your money or for the project. In giving, I give out of my own self, right? I give out of my own generosity. Fundraising doesn't build your character. Giving does. Generosity does. So we're not going to have products out there that say, well, if you give to this, it'll help with the missions. It's just not how we do it. It's not what's going to happen, okay? So I want you to learn that you cannot give out God. The more generous you are, and the more God is going to bless your life. So we're not going to sell anything. David says in 1 Chronicles chapter 21, talking about the offering for the temple, he says, I will not offer a sacrifice that costs me anything. So in other words, we don't do quid pro quo here, okay? The third thing is this. I didn't say quid pro Joe. I said quid pro quo. some of you get it. That's all right. Third thing we won't do. We won't promote products mixed with giving. We won't promote products mixed with giving. What do I mean? Well, every time we do a campaign, somebody comes to the pastor, not necessarily me, maybe Pastor Tom, somebody comes to the pastor and says, hey, pastor, I've got this great idea, right? I've got this great invention. I've got this little widget, or I've got this product, or I've got this service, and if you'll just let me come up on stage and tell everybody about my great product, and if you'll just promote my product, when they buy that product, then I'll tithe 10% back to the church. And I'm always like, wait, so you get 90% when I help you sell something, and the church gets 10%. This makes no sense to me. So what we don't do is we don't do it that way. We don't say, you know what, sure, come promote your product, give us 10%, we're happy with that. Listen, if you want to give, that's between you and God. But it's not between me and you, it's not between the church and you, but we don't, like I just said, we don't do quid pro quo. It's part of our values. We don't do fundraising. We're not gonna promote products mixed with, you know, giving and all that other stuff. What we will do, without apology, this is on your outline, what we will do without apology. Number one, we will show how everyone can give something. We will show how everyone can give something, because that's true. Everybody can give something, even if it's just a penny. Somebody gave me $3 last night. I know where that person comes from. I know what that person's going through. That $3, that was a sacrifice. And God is pleased with that, because, listen, everybody can give something. The widow in Scripture, the widow gave 2 mites, right? And Jesus said that the woman who had the 2 mites or the 2 pennies, whatever you want to call them, she gave more than the millionaire gave before her. Why would God say that? Because she gave all that she had, right? And when you give all that you have, when you give something like that, it's called faith. So we'll show how everybody can give something. Number two, we will ask people to sacrifice. I make no apology in saying to you that I want you to learn to make a sacrifice for the greatest cause in the world. What is that? It's the kingdom of God. It will last forever. There is no greater cause. We sacrifice for ourselves all the time, right? We take a loan out for a car, 72 months. Now we do 84 months, right? At 3%, 4%, 5% interest. Ever had a mortgage on a house? Ever rented a house, right? We make sacrifices. We make sacrifices all the time, but we make those sacrifices when they benefit us, when they're good on our behalf, right? We just don't want to do it when it comes to God. So we'll ask people to sacrifice. There are more promises in the Bible about giving than anything else. Number three, what we will do, we will follow the biblical pattern for an offering in 1 Chronicles chapter 29. This is where David is laying out the offering for building the temple of Jerusalem. And so we'll follow that principle. We'll follow that plan. So let me explain to you what you can expect over the next 10 weeks. Four things that you ought to expect. Number one, you ought to expect to see some miracles. We just sang about that, right? Waymaker, miracle worker, right? So you can expect to see some miracles because, listen, when people trust God, when people take risks, when they step out on faith, when they dream great dreams, when they go for God in faith, guess what happens? God moves. God shows up and he moves. God is not impressed with complaining. God is not impressed with griping. He's not impressed with criticizing all the time. Listen, it doesn't move God to act at all when I complain and when I whine and when I moan and all those things. But God moves according to our faith. That's what it's called, right? Daring faith. So God moves according to our faith. Every time God did a miracle in the Bible, every time God moved out of heaven and moved on earth, it's because somebody believed. Somebody had faith. The second thing you can expect is to grow spiritually. Why? Because we're going to be focusing through the messages in the coming week. We're going to be focusing on how you can grow spiritually. The third thing you can expect, and I hate to tell you this, but it's part of the deal when we step out on faith. The third thing that you can expect is you can expect to be hassled by Satan. You can expect to be attacked by Satan, okay? You're going to have some difficulties in the next 10 weeks. Satan's going to try to distract you. He's going to try to keep you from growing. Do you think Satan wants you to learn to live by faith? Absolutely not. Do you think he wants you to learn to be generous? Absolutely not. Do you think he wants you to learn to find ways and places that you have never gone before where you can sow in seeds of faith? Absolutely not. Why? Because that furthers the kingdom. That brings more people into the kingdom of God. Satan's whole plan, Satan's whole goal is to keep people out of the kingdom of God, right? So he's going to attack naturally. There are going to be problems. There are going to be things that happen. So you just need to be ready for that. The fourth thing you can expect is this. You can expect to experience joy. Expect to experience joy. When people learn how to set great dreams and how to dream great dreams and set big goals and take risks in life and live by faith, and make some sacrifices and invest their lives, they experience true joy in Jesus Christ. And so you can expect to, as you step out on faith, as you allow God to challenge your faith, as you begin to grow in your faith, you can expect to experience true joy. So that brings us to sermon number two this morning, part two. And we're going to talk about how faith in Jesus turns a little into a lot. Mark chapter 6, how faith in Jesus turns a little into a lot. Excuse me, one second. So this morning, Mark chapter 6, we're going to look at the most famous miracle that, arguably the most famous miracle that Jesus ever did, and it's the feeding of the 5,000, right? He took one little boy's lunch, and he was able to feed 5,000 people from it. So he turned a little into a lot. Some of you need this morning. Some of you need God to turn a little into a lot, and we're going to talk more about this, but you need to know these principles because many times for the rest of your life, you're going to need God to do these miracles, to turn a little into a lot, a little energy into a lot of energy, right? A little talent into a lot of talent, a little opportunity into a big opportunity, or a little bit of money, this is a little bit of money into a lot of money, right? Everybody said amen on that one, right? Little bit of health into great health. How does God turn a little into a lot? Well, that's what this story, that's what this miracle is all about. Jesus never did a miracle to show off. Every miracle that Jesus did was to teach a spiritual principle. And the spiritual truth of Jesus feeding the 5,000 is to show us how to prepare for a miracle where God turns a little into a lot. So this is a very important concept in this Daring Faith campaign. This miracle is so important. It's the only miracle that's told of Jesus four times in the New Testament. It's told in Matthew, it's told in Mark, it's told in Luke, it's told in John, okay? All four were so impressed with this miracle that they wrote about it. There were 5,000 people who saw it, and these guys said, you know what, listen, if God tells you something four times, I would think that it's probably a good idea to pay attention to it, right? So here's the story. Jesus just found out that John the Baptist had been beheaded. So he gets in a boat. He's sad. He wants to go to a remote area and be by himself. And the people found out where he was going. He was going from one part of the Sea of Galilee, some translations say the lake, okay? But he's going from one part of the Sea of Galilee to another. And the people found out where they were going. They all scurried around the lake, got to where he was going. And so Jesus gets there, and what do? They followed him. There's 5,000 people, and Jesus has compassion on them. He healed their sick. He began to teach. And at the end of the day, what happens is Jesus teaches all day. And at the end of the day, it's starting to get late and everybody's starting to get hungry. And they're 25 miles from the nearest Chick-fil-A. And the disciples, they, you know, you can't live without your God chicken, right? And so, Christian chicken. The disciples come to Jesus and they say, Lord, it's late in the day. Everybody's hungry. We don't know what to do. What should we do? And Jesus looks at him and he says, feed them. Just a matter of fact, Jesus is kind of like, well, feed them. What are you doing? What do you mean, what do you do? Just feed them. And I love this line because they kind of looked at Jesus and they're like, what's he talking about? Lord, that's impossible. 5,000, and the scripture says 5,000 men, okay? So we don't know how many women and children were there. So, I mean, probably way more than 5,000 people. But in other words, the disciples look at him and say, this is physically impossible, practically impossible, humanly impossible. What's going on here? Jesus is performing this first miracle to teach us the four steps of preparing to get ready for a miracle. So number one, here's the first step. Four keys to getting ready for a miracle. Number one, admit that I have an unsolvable problem. I have to admit that I have an unsolvable problem. Let me say this as clearly as I can. If you don't have an unsolvable problem, then you don't need a miracle. That should be obvious, right? If you don't have an unsolvable problem, then you don't need a miracle. If it's not unsolvable, then there's a way that you can find a solution. If you have a solvable problem, I would say to you this morning, then solve it. Just do it. God's giving you the power. He's giving you the ability. Solve it. People say stuff like this to me sometimes. Well, Pastor, oh my gosh, Pastor, I've gotten so overweight. I need a miracle. I need to lose weight. I'm like, you don't need a miracle. Stop eating the wrong things, right? You don't need a miracle. Just try a healthier diet. A lot of times we want miracles when God says, no, you're just overspending. The reason you're in so much debt is that you're overspending. You don't need a miracle. You need a spending plan, right? You need a budget. But the first step is to admit that we have an unsolvable problem. So here's the story in Mark chapter 6. When Jesus saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them, so he began teaching them. By this time, it was late in the day, so his disciples came and said, "This is a remote place." In other words, they were out away from town. "Send the people away so they can go and buy something to eat." But Jesus answered, "You give them something to eat." And the disciples looked back at him and said, "That would take 8 months of a man's wages." Think about that, 8 months of a man's wages. So they go all economics here on Jesus, you know. They start getting the calculators out. And in that verse and in that passage that I just read, we have three typical responses when we have an unsolvable problem. I don't think I gave you a place on your outline, but you could write these. We have three typical problems when we have an unsolvable problem. I think everybody probably does this. We procrastinate, we pass the buck, and we worry. We procrastinate, we pass the buck, and we worry. First thing we do, we procrastinate. When we have a problem we can't solve, what do? We just kind of keep putting it off, right? Keep pushing it off, okay? Like it's somehow miraculously going to go away. We know we need to solve it, but we don't know how to solve it, so we just keep putting it off. So we delay, we pretend it doesn't exist. We look the other way and all kinds of things like that. The phrase in this passage says, by this time, it was what? Late in the day. It was late in the day. In other words, they were procrastinating. The disciples knew. Like, they've been with Jesus before. They know the guy can preach a sermon. I mean, you think 40 minutes is bad. Jesus kept these people all day long, right? And so the disciples knew, like, at some point, people are going to get hungry. So they had all day to get their act together. They had all day to think about this and plan this out. But by this time, it was late in the day. They procrastinated. So procrastination only makes problems worse in your life. If you've got cancer, you don't put it off till next year, right? You deal with it now. You don't procrastinate. You deal with the issue now. What problem have you been procrastinating over in your life? I wonder what problem you know is there, and you're pretending it isn't a problem because you just don't want to deal with it. What problem are you pretending isn't in your marriage? What problem are you pretending isn't in your body? What problem are you pretending isn't in your finances? And then the next thing we do, not only do we procrastinate, we pass the buck. In other words, we blame other people. Well, it's not really my problem, it's her problem, or it's his problem, or it's their fault. We blame others. You've heard it said many times. You've heard me say this many times. How do you spell the word blame? You spell the word blame, be lame. Every time you blame somebody else, you are being lame, right? So the disciples said, you know what, Jesus, let's send them all away. What are they doing? They're passing off responsibility. They're passing the buck. They said, you know, we didn't invite these guys out here. They followed us. We were trying to go to a quiet place, you know, all that. We didn't ask them to come eat. We didn't promise them food. There was no meal plan set up, you know, and so they kind of thought, you know, out of sight, out of mind. And they said, let them find their own food, pass the buck. And then the third thing that we do is we worry with our problems. We fret, we stew, we get anxious, we get stressed out, all these other things. They said, Lord, it would take 8 months' wages to pay off all that food. And the disciples' anxiety kind of goes into overdrive. And I can just imagine Peter getting out his calculator and doing the cost analysis and saying, imagine the expense, 5,000 people. How are we ever going to import the food? How are we going to keep it hot and keep people from getting salmonella and all these other things? And how are we going to distribute it? And how are we going to get the health permits? And how are we going to make sure that we don't have any liability in case somebody chokes on a bone or something like that? Worry, worry, worry. Worry, right? And Jesus, that's what we do. Jesus looks at these 12 guys and he says, hey, I got a good idea. You feed them. You feed them. Me, Peter says? Are you kidding? We can't do that. Here's the point. They're procrastinating. They're passing the buck. They're worrying. What's the problem with this picture? There's a problem with this picture. What is it? The problem with this picture is they're standing next to Jesus. They're standing next to the Son of God. They're standing next to the guy who can easily turn the stones into bread if he wanted to. They're standing in the presence of the Son of God, and they're saying, what are we going to do? And Jesus is saying, you feed them. And so many times with our problems, we do this procrastinating and passing the buck and worrying. And the truth of the matter is that because of what Jesus did for us on the cross, we have the right to approach the throne of grace, and we can stand next to God, and we've got God standing next to us, and we're saying, what are we going to do? And we've got the answer right next to us the entire time. They're standing in the presence of the Son of God, and Jesus says, you feed them. And they look at God, and they look at Jesus, and they say, that's practically impossible. Listen. Question. Has God ever asked you to do something impossible? He loves to do that, you know. God loves to ask you to do something impossible. And you say, well, Lord, I don't have the time. Or, Lord, I don't have the money. Or, Lord, I don't have the energy. Or, Lord, I don't have the talent or the education. Or we say, God, you've got the wrong guy. Moses did that, right? Moses, he was asked to go free the Israelites from Egypt. God says, I want you to do this. And what does Moses say? Not me, God. I can't talk. I'm slow. Slow of speech, you know. God says, I'll send your brother Aaron to talk for you. And Moses is like, I still can't do it. You know, I got my flock out here. I'm comfortable, you know, all that stuff. He eventually goes, but what did Moses say? No, not me. Jeremiah said, why me, right? Jeremiah asked, why me, God? And then you've got Isaiah. Isaiah says, use me. Here am I, Lord. Use me. Send me. God says, I want you to do the impossible. Why does he ask that? Why does God ask you to do the impossible? Because he wants to stretch your faith. He wants to stretch that faith muscle. He wants it to grow a little bit stronger. When God asks you to do something you think is physically or financially impossible, he wants to stretch your faith. So that the first principle of a miracle is I have to admit that I have an unsolvable problem that I'm facing right now. I have to admit that I've got a problem that seems unsolvable. Principle number two, give God what little I already have. This is the second step to get to a miracle. Give God what little I already have. Jesus says to the disciples, I want you to do a little reconnaissance. I want you to go check things out. Go out and see if anybody has any food. Go out and see if anybody has any lunches. And so he says, how many loaves do you have? Jesus asked. Go and see. When they found out, they said, we have 5 small loaves and 2 fish. One little boy has a sack, right? I thought about this. I'm like, wait a minute. 5,000 people and only one little boy was smart enough to bring food with them? I mean, come on. There's got to be some rich people sitting around with their picnic baskets under their robes or something, hiding it all. They find one little boy that's got food out of 5,000 people. It's hard to believe that he's the only one that brought this little lunch. But anyway, mom had packed him these 5 little loaves and these 2 dried fish or whatever, and he becomes the hero of the story because he's willing to offer up what little he has. He gives God what little he has. Why did Jesus do this? Why did Jesus say, hey, go find out how many lunches there are. Find out how many loaves of bread are out there among the crowd. He didn't need a lot to do. He didn't need anything to do a miracle, right? I mean, Jesus could have just said, hey, bread for everybody, and manna could have fallen from heaven, and it would have been like, hey, all right, we're all eating today, right? There's a million different ways to do this. Why did he do this? Because the second principle of a miracle is this: God always starts with what I have. God always starts with what I have. In other words, God will always start with what you have, whether it's a little, whether it's a lot. He always starts with what you have. May not be much, but we give it to God. God, I don't have much time, but here's my time. God, I don't have much finances, but here's my finances. God, you know, my talent isn't much, but here it is. Use it. God, here's everything in my life. Use it. My reputation, my heart, my soul, my past, my present, my future, whatever that might be. It isn't much, God, but I'm going to give it all to you to use however you see fits. It's interesting that God always starts with what I have. John 6:6 tells a little detail of the story. John says, he asked this only to test them, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Jesus wasn't sweating it. Jesus already knew. Jesus knew what he was going to do. He was just kind of like testing their faith a little bit, right? Stretching their faith a little bit. When God asks you to do the impossible, he's not sweating it. Don't ever forget that. Sometimes God asks you to do something impossible. Guess what? He's not worried. You know why? Because he knows that he's got an answer for the problem. He's waiting on you to figure that out with him, to rely on him, to trust him. He already has in mind what he's going to do. He saw the need way before, long before you did. He had a plan. So I would write this down, an important truth. God always has the answer before I know the problem. God always has the answer before I even know the problem. In your life, God always has the answer before you know what the problem is going to be. And he saw the problem. It's not late in the day for Jesus. Jesus saw it way before. He knew it was coming. He already had a plan. God already knows the solution to your problem before it ever gets to you. So why are you worrying? So that's one of the principles of a miracle. I have to admit I have an unsolvable problem. Then I have to give God what little I have. Number three, I have to put it all in the hands of Jesus. You and I have to put it all in the hands of Jesus. Sometimes that's hard because we don't like to let go of things. And in John's account of this miracle, it tells a little detail that the Andrew disciple finds this one little boy had brought the sack lunch and that his mom had packed him, and it wasn't much, but he's got these two fish and these five loaves of bread, and there might have been others that had food, but this boy becomes the hero because he put it all in the hands of Jesus. And the Bible says in verse 41, Jesus took the five loaves and the two fish, he blessed the food, and he broke the loaves, and he kept giving them to the disciples to set before the people. So here's the third principle. God will use whatever I give him. God will use whatever I give him. It may not be much, but if I give him a little time, a little energy, a little effort, whatever I've got, if I give it to God, guess what? He's going to use it. Now, I don't have time to get into this, but we could do a detailed study looking at the other verses of the other ways that this little boy gave. How did he give? He gave willingly. He gave cheerfully. He gave immediately, which are all keys to miracles. Giving willingly, cheerfully, immediately, all keys to miracles. Willingly, Matthew tells us that he volunteered. Let me ask you, 5,000 people and everybody is hungry. Would you share your lunch? Probably not in today's society, right? You know, we teach our little kids to share. But as adults, we grow up and somehow, strangely, we have a much harder time with that than what we've tried to teach our own children to do. You're in a crowd of 5,000 people. Everybody is hungry. Not many people would willingly share their lunch. But not only did he willingly share his lunch, he did it cheerfully. He didn't grumble. He didn't complain. He didn't worry. And then he did it immediately. As soon as he saw the need, he said, Jesus, take my lunch. It's okay. And he gave his lunch over to be used. No hesitation. Because of that, we come to the fourth key to a miracle. Write this down. I expect God to multiply it. I have to expect God to multiply it. I give God whatever I have. I put it in the hands of Jesus, and then I expect God to multiply it. Notice what happens. Mark chapter 6, verse 42. Everyone ate. That's all 5,000 that are mentioned and any of the extra people that were there. Everyone ate and had enough. Afterwards, they collected how many? 12 baskets full of leftovers. Afterwards, they collected 12 basketfuls of leftovers. They're going home with doggy bags today, right? Jesus doesn't just satisfy everybody. He makes a spiritual lesson out of this. Why? Because the 12 obviously represents something. What do you think the 12 represents? The 12 tribes of Israel, right? Why? Because Jesus came for each and every one of them. Jesus came for all 12 tribes, not 5 of the 12, not 6 of the 12. So there's 12 baskets full left that are going home. And I love this. This is not in Scripture, but I'm just kind of imagining because I have my own kids, right? And I think about this. And imagine this kid goes home and he's got these 12 baskets full of fish and loaves and everything else. I mean, that is like weeks and weeks and weeks worth of food. And mom looks at the kid and it's like, where did you get all that? Did you rob the market? What happened? You know, that kind of thing. No, mom, you never believe it. You know those 5 little loaves and the 2 fishes that you gave me? I gave those to Jesus and he multiplied it and everybody ate and we had so much left. We had 12 basketfuls left over, mom. So Jesus said, I could bring it all home to you. And mom looks at the little boy and says, you go to your room and wait till your father gets home. You think about whether you can tell us the truth or not before you come back out, right? And he's like, no, mom, you don't understand. You know, like, Jesus really did this miracle, and he really multiplied all the food and everything. And she's like, no, you just stay there. Your father's going to deal with you, son. You better be ready to tell the truth when he gets home. Like, that's how we act, right? Would you believe a story like that? It's mind-boggling. What do we call that? We call that a miracle. So here's the fourth principle. We might write this down. Whatever I give, I always get back more. Whatever I give, I always get back more. This is not prosperity gospel. This is not believe it and receive it kind of thing, okay? This is, or name it and claim it, whatever you want to call it. This is God honoring the faithful, cheerful, willing giver. And when that little boy gave what little bit he had, God said, you know what? You might have been worried you weren't even going to eat. But now look, you got 12 baskets full. It's going to feed your family for 2 months. Right? This little boy's lunch not only blessed 5,000 people, but he ends up being richer himself because of his generosity. And I could give you a lot of testimonies to that one, but how God blesses you as you try to bless others, he pours out, he opens the floodgates of heaven. You cannot outgive God. You always end up with more than you started with. So here's the point, here's the big lesson. Listen, God likes to do miracles through people, not independently. God always likes to do miracles through people. He likes to work through your ordinariness, if that's a word, okay? What we wait for God to do for us, God is waiting to do through us. I'll say it again. What we wait for God to do for us, God wants to do through us. So during Daring Faith, during these 10 weeks, God wants to turn your life into a miracle machine. He doesn't want to just do something for you. He wants to do something through you so that other people can see it, so that you can be a walking miracle for other people to witness, like he did through this little boy who gave him his lunch. It wasn't much, but he gave all that he had. And God takes it, and he breaks it, and he blesses it, and he multiplies it. And God wants to do that in so many ways in your life as well. The Bible says in Mark chapter 10, verse 27, all things are possible with God. All things are possible with God. What is the ultimate example of that? What is the ultimate example of all things are possible with God? We know that all things are possible with God because of Easter. Easter's right around the corner, and it's coming fast. Because listen, if God could raise a person from the dead, he can do anything. If God can raise a dead human being, then listen, he can raise a dead marriage. If God can raise a dead human being, then he can raise a dead career. If God can raise a dead human being, then he can raise a dead dream. If he could raise dead finances, or he can raise a dead body. And God, listen, if he can raise a dead body, God can do anything, and Easter proves it. The Bible says in the Old Testament, is anything too hard for the Lord? The answer is obviously no. And Easter is the ultimate example of that. The greater the sacrifice, the greater the results. Easter proves that the greater the sacrifice, the greater the results. Jesus pays the ultimate sacrifice, giving his life for the sins of all mankind, for you, for me, for everyone. And he didn't just die on a cross. He died to take my guilt. He died to take my shame. He died to take your guilt. He died to take your shame. To be my Lamb of God and to be your Lamb of God. And in doing that, it results in the salvation of the world. And all of us, each and every one of us, can enter into that same salvation. So his ultimate sacrifice made it possible for anybody to be saved. Jesus said it like this, last verse. Jesus said it like this in John chapter 12, a kernel of wheat must be given away and planted in the soil. In other words, if I have a packet of seeds up here and I'm holding a packet of seeds, that packet of seeds doesn't do any good. It doesn't reproduce. It doesn't do anything just sitting on the shelf or just sitting in my hand, right? Unless it dies and is buried, Scripture says, and he's talking about his own death and burial here, unless it dies and is buried, it will remain a single seed or a packet of seeds, but its death will produce many more seeds and a great harvest. Jesus' death produced many more seeds and a great harvest. Christianity spread from Jerusalem and Judea and those parts all the way to the Roman Empire. In Rome and Rome and Italy and Greece and Turkey, it spread all to all those different nations, and Christians were born out of that all around the world. We sit here today because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That seed that was planted has now sprouted, and there's a great harvest to be reaped, and we are part of reaping that harvest. We're called to go out and witness and share the good news and bring in the harvest. All things are possible with God. And he doesn't want to just do a miracle for you. He wants to do a miracle through you. So this morning, as we close, I'd ask you just bow your heads, close your eyes, or just close your eyes. I don't know, but just in the stillness of this moment, what is the miracle that you need? I don't know what it is today. Where is it that you need to admit that you have an unsolvable problem? Maybe you need to just talk to God. It's not from, I could pray for you, but it's better if you pray to God yourself. Approach him yourself. Talk to him right where you sit. No special words. God, I've got an unsolvable problem. God, I've been holding on to what little I have, and I know I need to give it to you. Or, you know, God, let me put this stuff in your hands, like that little boy did. Maybe you need to ask God to give you a little more faith that he'll multiply what you give him. We still serve to this day. We serve a living, risen Savior, a God who is still in the miracle business. What are your needs this morning? I don't know what it is. Maybe it's broken relationships. Maybe it's a broken marriage. Maybe it's finances. Maybe it's, you know, you don't even know where your next meal is going to come from. Talk to God about that. But God, I need a miracle this morning. God, I need you to grow my faith. God, I need you to stretch my faith. What is it? I believe that the God that we serve is a way maker. He's a miracle worker. He's a promise keeper. My God, your God is a light in the darkness. That's who he is, right? He's the way maker. He's a promise keeper. What do you need to talk to God about this morning? Marriage, he's a way maker. In your families, he says, I'm here to be the way maker, right? Do you believe that this morning? In your place of employment, work relationships, he is. In your loneliness, Scripture says that he is your this morning. Sing that out to him this morning.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
stand up and sing it with us. He is the what? He's the way maker,
miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
In your finances, in your marriage, he is way maker,
miracle worker.
Tell him this morning, he is
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Who is he? Who is he this morning to you? He is
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
One more time. Make this your prayer this morning. Let them know you believe this morning. Waymaker,
miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
God, that is our declaration this morning. We believe that you are the waymaker. We believe that you are the miracle worker, that you are a promise keeper, and that you are our light in a dark, dark world. And that as we follow you, that you will make our path straight. You will be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. And so, God, I pray this morning for those who are hurting, those who are struggling, those with relationship issues, those with financial issues, whatever they may be, God, I pray that you'll help us this week to admit that we have a problem, an unsolvable problem, that we can't do without you, and that we'll place our faith and our trust in you this week. God, this week when Satan attacks and when he challenges our faith, I pray that you'll help each and every person here to remember and to declare with confidence and boldness that you are their way maker, you are their miracle worker, you are their promise keeper, and their light in a dark, dark world. Lord, we love you and we thank you, and I pray your blessing on each and every person here this morning. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen, amen. Amen. Take this with you.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.